Thanks, Kai. Happy to be here again after last year. We gave some more insights about the evolvement of the KiwiCom platform based on ESH. And today, we would give a short overview about tooling. It should be primarily a demo, but nevertheless, I had some few slides. So first about me, some colleague of Kai and working for Deutsche Telekom as evangelist, architect, how you name it. Unfortunately, I'm doing toolless technology. Hope that can change over the next month, year again. So going to be more on the code level, hopefully. We have at EclipseCon on Wednesday, together with a colleague, with Amit here, a presentation or talk about how we did migrate from our KiwiCon development environment from PDE using Maven Tyco to BND tools. So we did that half a year, or it takes half a year to make this process. We had some learnings about that, so if you join the EclipseCon for free, to join the talk so we can get more details. What I did in preparation is, as I said, trying to do a more demo. I just put up a workspace, which basically is the Eclipse Smart Home environment running in BND tools. So just to give you maybe a short comparison how it's different to the previous one. What I have here is Eclipse PDE, just checked out with the standard UMF installer. Checked it out from the repo, you see the smart home from the master, and you see all the artifacts checked out. And it's structured in different areas, so the bundles, with the core bundles, I/O bundles, the extensions, and so on, all the feature stuff for the Carafe features, and so on. In the BND tools space, it looks a little bit different, because in BND tools, I call it smart home BND tools here, everything is flat. So one of the properties of the BND tools is that you have everything in your workspace in a flat structure. All of the bundles are within here, as you see, and a lot of them, in a flat directory. And the main directory is the CNF folder, which describes your environment. So going back to Eclipse, you see here the CNF folder, which describes your environment. Just as a short excursion here, just go to this file here. You might think, how did I set up the workspace? So fortunately, there is a small tool we just use also in KiwiCon space. That's an extension on the BND tool from Peter Queens. This part is not yet published publicly available. So we have just an internal version here. But just to illustrate how it's working, so we can do something like a PDE convert. So it goes down a complete directory structure, taking all the projects here, you mentioned see here, and tries to set up a build path based on the dependencies. And sometimes some stuff are missing, or maybe he's choosing the wrong one, so we can give him additional instructions to set up the build path. That's something I did. We also did in our KiwiCon space, so I had some experience on that. Was some work to do that. But at the end, I could run a simple shell script which just does the complete PDE conversion in one step, and I get the complete workspace up and running here. One of the primary concepts of BND tools is, that's what's in PDE you find as the SONIM target platform, is the repositories. So everything you're building again or running against is part of repositories. BND tools and BND supports different kinds of repositories. I primarily choose two different ones, and the whole build environment will be defined here in a file which is called the build.bnd. That's more or less the master build instruction file for your whole workspace, including all the projects. And what we define here is the repositories. I defined one for the runtime, and in that case, I choose a Maven repository, which refers to artifacts described in the file here. And that's just a list of the artifacts I use here for building, from OSGI artifacts to some common libraries, and so on and so on. The other way you can use here is just to use P2 repositories. I just mimic the same one like used in the target platform. So there's, I think, about 10 different P2 repos in the target platform. Some of them I just use one by one, like the Chuck.js connector, other sites, UPnP, what else, Paho from the IoT project, the Jetty, third-party repos, and so on. There's one limitation on the BND support for P2 repos. You cannot define something like a filter. Like you can do it here on the Maven repo, you can define a list of artifacts to be reused. That's something I will create an issue for BND and maybe provide an implementation, hopefully. So in the case for the Orbit, for example, there's a so big number of artifacts in that, so it tend to use the wrong version then for different artifacts. So you have to specify a filter like you have within the target platform. We can define a unit which defines which kind of artifacts to be used. In that case, I decided to use also P2 repos as a local version. I just checked them in, just as a workaround, especially for the whole Xtext or model-based stuff, EMF and Xtext, because they just no different update sites at the moment. At least I didn't find anyone. They're just part of the Photon release, which is very huge and didn't make sense to put everything into, so I just used here as a local P2 repo. So everything which you define here will be visible here in the repo browser. So you can define or can search for all your artifacts, for example, the libraries for the measurement of units, the tech ones here, or what else. That's kind of your navigation through all your repository artifacts in your repos. I also defined because of the Wi-Fi issues to go in offline mode at the moment. So you can also use that if you're not connected online, otherwise you get any resolution problems. Okay, so that's more or less a first introduction on that one. That's the whole infrastructure on the IDE side. What comes with as a very, very good add-on, as a core concept, and it's what we also was one of the reasons why we moved over in our KiwiCon commercial development to BND tools, that this command line build is completely based on Gradle. So everything you're doing here in these configuration files will automatically be supported on the command line. And just to give you some numbers, I just run the build some minutes ago. The whole build of the system here takes 1.5 minutes, which is okay. And just compiling one individual bundle takes about some seconds only, so that's good. At least compared to the Maven Tycho build, so if everything from the internet is downloaded, it takes about 5 minutes, 6 minutes for the whole build. So was my measurement on my machine here. Okay. That's one interesting stuff, but what is the main reason why we choose also to go over from the PDE build to the PDE system to the BND tools? We have, like a lot of other projects, a very mixed build of Maven Tycho, a lot of P2 repos, pushing everything to our Nexus repositories with the artifacts. So during the last years, we struggled into some issues about synchronization of all these different build jobs, and sometimes you come into situations where one build shop publishes something into that one, the other one refers to the artifacts, and something went wrong. Infrastructure did fail, or the references have not been correct. So we struggle a lot around that, and because we also structured our code in multiple Git repositories, it was not so easy to have one single workspace containing every kind of code and have a complete build where you know if you change one line of code, what does it mean for the whole system? So part of our move over to BND tools, that we also change the code structure completely. So we put everything which is now running on the gateway side into one single workspace. So we have 300 plus bundles now, where about 100 are test bundles. We changed completely our CI/CD pipeline to use the Gradle build, which is much more better than now. It's even much more faster than before, and much more reliable. Why we did the change to BND tools, that's one part of that, but I have a strong wish as the responsible architect for the gateway software. We, like in Eclipse Smart Home, we only use semantic versioning in specific parts of the platform, and we want to get a much better support to version the packages of our software in a well-defined way. And I just want to give a short explanation how this will work here. I don't know who's familiar with the semantic versioning concept, with the stuff. Not so many, so just maybe a short explanation. So there's a very good white paper from the OSGI Alliance about semantic versioning and how does it fit to the OSGI concept. So I really recommend to read the paper. I read it sometimes, so it's really very good information. I just pick up as a sample here one specific code base here in the Eclipse Smart Home. They recently introduced, some months ago, the HTTP Client Factory. That's in the package io.net.http, I think. I forgot the HTTP here. Okay. This interface, it's a Java interface, is intended to be implemented by specific client factory implementations which might can be different ones in the platform. Eclipse Smart Home bring its own. We could also choose to develop our own one because we have different requirements for SSL, trust providers, what else? You can decide to bring your own. And in the platform, we have multiple bundles which uses this HTTP client factory. For example, I picked out the OAuth client service impl, which tries to connect to some external OAuth provider like NetApmo or Nest, what else. So that's the scenario here. And for semantic versioning, what I did here, that's not in the original code of ESH. I just go to the bundle here. And you see here one file, which is the other part of the configuration for a bundle, the so-named bnd.bnd file. This one has been automatically generated by the conversion script. So there's nothing we did manually. This just came out of the migration. And you see here the build path, which has been compiled together. You can also see here the export packages, which has been identified from the previous manifest also. Yes, and what I define here now as part of semantic versioning, I have to say this HTTP package here is something which will be provided to the external world. So which means from the semantic paper, it's called a provider type. So it provides an interface which has to be respected by the implementations. I gave the package itself a version, this one here, a package info. I used the BND the OSGI annotations for that one, so just in the version of 1.0. And what I see here in the BND tools, you see that the export version is 1.0 with a range for the imports for 1.0 to 1.1. And 1.1 is excluded. So now it's again about what does happen if I change something on the code level. Maybe as a side note here, BND tools will automatically generate all the time you do any change on your bundles or on your source code, generate the artifact. This here, the jar file. You can just click on it and see immediately what's inside the jar file. And you can also see in a readable way the manifest. So what I see now here, because I introduced semantic versioning to this HTTP package, that the export is done here in the version 1.0.0. But it's imported as 1.0 up to 1.1 because there is one, and that's something in the internal package, which is as a, marked as a private package here, by one of the implementations, that one. And what I did here, I just introduced for the semantic versioning concept to declare this implementation as a so-named provider type because it provides the required interface. So, that's the reason why this bundle decides to import only from 1.0 to 1.1 excluding. And if I just go to the consumer type, that's this bundle here. It's just here doing an, where's the import package? It's already generated, you're right. You see here, that's a consumer here, and the version range is, because it's a consumer type, it just has to react on major version changes. It's from 1.0 to version 2 excluding. So let's now do a small change here on the interface. For example, one case would be just to add a new method, which means it does break all the implementations now. because every implementer of this interface has also to provide the implementation of that one. So can just fix it here. Yeah. Just make a public void new method. Regarding to the versioning, you in that case have to now upgrade your version because you just incremented the interface, but without breaking the major the external API. So you can upgrade to 1.1. And what you see now is that BND tools takes care about all the versioning stuff. So you don't have to go to the manifest, maintain anything. You can just see that now the version of the package is exported as 1.1, which is expected, but the import also has been upgraded to 1.1 to up to 1.2, excluding again. So this will automatically be handled by the tooling side. You don't have to care about that as long as you are aware of upgrading your version number in your package info file. So that's something that is up to your mind. The same one also on the client side, because now in the current workspace, I compile against the version 1.1, so the minimum expected version is now also the 1.1 up to version 2. So that's the behavior on the semantic versioning side. Looking at the time here, I could... Yes, for the baseline, I would have to set up the space here mid immersion, so it was a little bit more work for me to do. The real benefit will come then to place, as Vijay said, if you can define a baseline version. So the whole build process can now check if I, as developer, forgot to change the version info, because now we can see, oops, your interfaces, your declared providers have been changed, and you are enforced to upgrade your version. And if you do not, you will get an error on your CI/CD chain. So that's the basic stuff behind that. I didn't get up that running for this demo here, but this is really the core benefits you get using the BND tools, that all the versioning stuff is really at your hands, and you're really enforced to do that and not forget about that. Because we do also semantic version, but we have to maintain it in our minds, and that normally something goes wrong. It doesn't work at the end. That's more or less main stuff I wanted to show as a short introduction on this one here. I'm maintaining a GitHub project to do that stuff. To be honest, what's missing is the modeling stuff and the UI stuff, which is both a little bit crappy because it's the EMF stuff and the JavaScript. So it's definitely more work to be integrated on that. But I think it was up to now a really good step forward. So I was happy to see that really running for this part. Okay, thank you.